This is WCRN Weekend with your host, Pat Rice.
Welcome to another episode of WCRN Weekends with Pat Rice on AM 830. And on today's episode, we have another WCRN host stopping by the studio, Bob G, who is the founder of Triton Financial. He has a lot of experience within economics and finances, and he even hosts his own show along with his co-host John entitled Financial Focus. And today we're going to talk to Bob about how he got into the world of finances and much more. Hi, Bob. Thank you for coming on to our show today. How are you?
You got it, Pat. Thanks for having me on. And the G, by the way, stands for Gustafson.
Thank you. I'm still working on my pronunciation.
That's all right. I won't hold it against you. It's a tough name to pronounce for some people.
Thank you, though. But I like it. The Bob G. You know, the G stands out, the capital G.
So the question was, how did I get in the business?
Yeah. Could you tell us about the history of Triton Financial?
Sure.
And your journey into the world of economics and finances?
Sure. Yeah, well, interesting. When I got out of college, my background is in finance and economics. And I had actually gone out to visit some friends in California. And while I was out there, I met a person who was a senior VP at an investment banking firm. We became good friends, and my plan was to come back here and work toward a graduate degree or a PhD in economics. And lo and behold, they made me an offer before I came back to go to work for the firm, believe it or not.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, and the weather was nice out there, too.
Oh, yeah.
Let's not forget that. And I was in my early 20s, single, and I was in California.
You have the whole world in your hands.
I felt like that at the time. But the problem was I got homesick. You know, all my family was back here, and my grandmother was getting up there, and she wasn't doing that well. But I loved the industry, and so when I came back here, I immediately went in search of continuing my career at a financial planning firm. And so I spent a couple of years there. I realized that I really didn't enjoy working in a large company setting. I didn't like working for a company. I wanted to work for people. I didn't want a company telling me what I had to recommend for people based on a profit margin. So the only thing I could do was become an independent advisor. And that was where, at the time, RK Gustafson Financial was formed, which later became RKG Financial, which later became Triton Financial.
Wow. And that's great. You really seem like a go-getter. You know, I would consider you as an entrepreneur for creating your own business, right? And so what's the difference between smaller independent boutique firms compared to the larger corporate ran firms?
Well, with a smaller firm, it depends. There's a lot of different types of smaller firms. But in our case, we have a particular niche, and it's doing comprehensive financial planning for people, which is looking at everything holistically. My industry as a whole, you know, when you look at the larger firms, they don't really like to do that. And it's because it takes a lot of work, and it's not profitable. So the large companies, they want to stick toward the product sales, you know, the selling of the investments, mutual funds, brokerage, annuities, those sorts of things. But for us, it's a different game. It's, you know, let's do the planning first. Let's really get into somebody's situation. And then we can look at what the product offering might need. So we spend a lot of time on the financial planning aspect of it. And that is why companies don't like to do that, because it's not as profitable.
Exactly.
It's the bottom line.
You guys put the people first before the money, which is great, because when people think about major companies, the first thing that comes to mind is numbers and money, and that's what makes financial different compared to the other firms. And so what is the key behind smart investing? How can one accumulate wealth for retirement?
Well, you know, interesting is it comes down to your mindset. What do you really want? And that's where people go wrong today, I think, is everybody thinks too short term, too much in today, and not enough for tomorrow. And what happens is when you think today, you tend to spend more money on the things of today rather than having an eye on tomorrow. And so if you really want to prepare for your future, you've got to take a look at where you are today, and you've got to allocate more money toward the future than what most people do. You really want to make sure that you're taking a look at your earnings, your income, and making sure that you put money away for retirement. That's important. And it's also a good idea to have a goal. See, what happens is, believe it or not, people, when they have a goal, the likelihood of achieving that goal is much higher if you write it down or have an idea of what you're working toward. Mm-hmm. And that holds true not just in finances, by the way, but in anything else. You want to set a weight loss goal. Well, you're more likely to hit a weight loss goal if you set a target than if you don't.
Yeah.
Same thing in the financial arena. So what we try to recommend people do is come up with a number and hit a target and work toward that goal. And so that's the most effective way we've found for people to hit long-term, be successful long-term in the retirement planning arena is to set goals.
Definitely. So when should one start investing in themselves, and how much money should an individual start with while they're investing?
Well, you should start yesterday. You know, you can't, it's not soon enough. In fact, I even, you know, a lot of the things that we do is when we have, you know, clients, we're recommending, especially self-employed clients, we actually recommend that, you know, when they have children that are old enough to work, put them on the payroll. Put that, you know, put money in a Roth IRA for them, you know, those types of things. You want to start as early as you possibly can. You want to start training your mind early for savings and not for spending. If you can do that, it increases the chances of financial success dramatically in the long run if you can do that. The challenge is most people just can't seem to do that.
Mm-hmm.
There are people who can, but it seems to be very hard for the population as a whole to do that. It's a tough mindset.
Yeah, we live in a very conglomerate society nowadays. We have malls, plazas all over the place. You walk into a mall, it's a store within a store, and it just drains your pockets.
And the fact that you can pull a credit card out of your wallet and spend money that you don't even have yet makes it a lot harder. I think, you know, for me, one of the biggest beefs I have in the world today are credit cards.
Mm-hmm.
They do a number on people. I really wish that concept was never invented.
Really?
I really do. I really do.
But people tell me, oh, you need to build up your credit. Is this true? To me, I think it's a lie. I don't want to say a lie, but it's just to get you to get a credit card.
Well, it does. It can build up your credit, yes. I think that's a fair thing to say. But what happens to most people is they can't control it.
Mm-hmm.
And it just becomes problematic for them. And so many people fall behind the eight ball because of credit cards. And I think for most people, most of the time, they really don't need as much credit as they have. And I think most people just run into trouble with it. For the average American.
Yeah. So what does credit usually apply to? Like buying a house, a car? But besides that, I mean...
Well, basically, the easiest kind of credit you can get, I think, is probably a car maybe a smaller credit card. To get the house, it's a different story. You've got to have built up some credit. So you need a history.
Mm-hmm.
So having a credit card and, you know, paying it off on a regular basis, that's helpful. Having a car, paying it off on a regular basis, that helps. It builds your credit score. So when you go to buy that house, you have credit.
Mm-hmm.
And that's important. And so as much as I hate credit cards, they are somewhat of a necessity today in helping to build some level of credit.
It seems like credit cards are basically just to show proof that you can pay off your bills.
Yeah, and that's what they do. That's what your credit score is a function of the level of credit you have and your history in paying on time.
Hmm.
That's key. You know, if somebody's going to lend you $300,000 to buy a house, well, they want to get their money back and they want to look at you as a borrower, and well, what's your history been with other loans that you've had?
Absolutely.
It just makes sense.
And would you say that saving money to live a comfortable lifestyle is a lot harder nowadays compared to 20 years ago?
Yes and no. I think yes because people have too much, it's too easy to spend money today. And also the short-term mindset that people have.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people think that it was so much easier to do things years ago. Well, it really wasn't. It was a different mindset. In past generations, you know, when you look at a couple of generations ago, there were people that lived through the Great Depression. And that was a real horrible situation. I mean, the soup lines and everything else, it was a real tough time in American history. You also had World War II, which was pretty challenging for people to get through. But recent generations haven't seen any of that. So they don't have that history behind them of going through what a really bad time is like.
Mm-hmm.
So most people today aren't aware of how bad times can get.
Oh, yeah.
So they don't think like, oh, I got to really put some money away. Well, what if this happens? What if that happens? They don't think like that.
No, I think we're kind of spoiled. And I think the sad thing is, it seems like a lot of the, not to get completely off topic, but a lot of generations, the recent generations today, are kind of forgetting about the past history. And you think about these name changes within our communities, like Faneuil Hall. They want to change the name of Faneuil Hall because it's offensive.
Really? I hadn't heard that one.
Because like, I guess the guy that it was named after was involved with slavery. But people are like, oh, we can't have some guy who's involved with slavery, like representing this part in Boston. But the thing is, you can't erase every piece and bit of history because people won't know what the history was before us. And they end up making the same mistakes over and over again. And that's kind of sad that we have Google and all this technology that not too many kids or guys my age can tell you a whole lot about, oh, well, what happened yesterday, you know?
Right, right.
So that goes into, how can people change their mindset? How can people get a better mindset and how to save? And how can one quickly pay off their student loan debt?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what you've got to do is you've got to, if you want to be financially successful, the one thing I tell everybody is you've got to learn to live within your means, okay? You want to, so instead of going out and buying a Lexus, get a Toyota Corolla or a, you know, a Honda Civic or an Accord or something like that. You don't necessarily need to have the Lexus.
Mm-mm.
Maybe someday you can,
yeah.
But you know what? Live within your means. And when talking about living in your means, you've got to, in that calculation, figure out what you're going to need for tomorrow. Not just for today, but for tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So living within your means is huge, and it's a very hard thing for people to do. And also, you want to become financially educated. I just think there's such a void in the world today of financial sophistication that it's amazing to me. Of how little, so you want to educate yourself, try to learn about the subject, learn what different investments are, learn what mutual funds are and ETFs and all these other different things, and do your best to live within your means. And one way to do that is to look at what your expenses are on a monthly basis. Look at where your money's going. Look at how you're spending it. If you don't know where your money's going, you'll never know where it went, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
no.
You want to, you know, keep a close eye on that so you can see where it's going. And it's like when we talked a few minutes earlier, you know, about the diet analogy.
Yeah.
Well, if you're counting calories, it makes it easier to try to hit your goal because you're cognizant about what you're eating and what the caloric intake is, right? Well, the same thing with money. If you know where your money's going and you can see it in front of you and you say, ah, geez, you know what? I've been spending a lot of money at Starbucks lately. You know what I'll do? Maybe I'll just tone it back. And instead of getting a large, I'll get a small. And instead of going 7 days a week, I'll go four. And 3 days, I'll make coffee at home or something like that. Or stop by Cumberland Farms and spend a dollar and spend instead of five.
Yeah.
Right? It's little things like that. But those little things that you do train your mind and help you get where you want to go.
So true. After you do it, after a couple of weeks, it just becomes second nature. I'm not stopping at Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts to get your coffee. You bring like some fruit and a coffee from home, and before you know it, you save up money over time,
right.
And it accumulates fast.
And you get that same high. It's a high when you hit a goal.
Oh yeah.
So when you hit a savings goal, let's say your goal was to save $5,000.
Yeah.
You know, and you're skimping over here, you're not spending as much in Starbucks, you're not doing this or that. You hit that goal and boy, do you feel good about it. And now you have $5,000 in the bank that you never otherwise would have had. Now you're starting to accumulate, you're getting yourself in that pattern.
Mm-hmm.
It's like working out. First time you go to the gym and you kind of hate it. After a while, you get excited to go because you're hitting different milestones. You set those types of savings goal and milestones, you get that high from that.
Yeah, and it gets addicting. Like you reach 10,000 and then all of a sudden you're like, that's
just 10,000. Wow, let me go to 25.
Exactly. Back in the day when 10,000 seemed like, oh, all the money in the world, you get there, you're like, 10,000 is nothing. Let's go to
exactly.
The next level. That's one thing I learned from saving. I find it enjoyable. That's why when I get
that's
my check,
awesome.
I can't wait to, you know, just I always get the amounts on my receipts. I'm always seeing, okay, so next week I should have this, the week after that I should have that. And so I think it's something that people, a lot of people get into, and it's really fun.
It can be. It can be. You just got to get yourself to that point. And if you can get yourself to that point, you're there. Mm. You really are. Once you get that mindset, you're there.
Yeah, and especially if you have someone helping or leading you like Triton Financial. And you guys work in all different kind of avenues. Could you tell us some of the avenues that you guys tackle when it comes to investing, such as like portfolio management, insurance planning, estate planning, and so forth?
Yeah, well, on the investment management side, we manage, I think our firm is up to over, you know, $120 million in the amount of money we manage for families and folks. And so we use the various tools that we use are mutual funds, ETFs, stocks, bonds. So we do all that type of stuff. You know, on the insurance side, we help folks make insurance decisions. We help them all the way across the board from, you know, life, disability, long-term care, home and auto liability, you name it, and we advise clients on. On the estate planning side, we work closely with so many different estate planning attorneys across the state, helping our clients get those estate planning documents in order. We help people understand what they need, help them understand the legal speak from the attorney so they can understand what they're doing. And that's more or less how we help people. So we, you know, get together with them, understand their goals, resources, timeframes, put a plan together. Help them manage their assets across the board, not just with, you know, also including their 401k plans, things like that they have through their employers. We look at the work benefits, all that fun stuff. It's all figured into the analysis and the comprehensive planning we do.
What are some of the biggest issues that people come to you for?
Usually college and retirement planning are the two biggies for most of the people most of the time. And it's a challenge because college has become so expensive that if the average person doesn't get a good jump start in preparing for it, it's unlikely they're going to get there. Mm-hmm. And what that means is they're probably going to be in debt, and their children are going to be in debt at the same time when they need to be preparing for retirement. And that can be problematic. Mm-hmm. It's a big problem. In fact, they're calling this generation the sandwich generation, where not only are we taking care of our children, but aging parents as well, because aging parents, so people living longer, are running out of money. So we're getting hit from both sides. So they call it the sandwich generation. So you really, these are some of the reasons why you really want to think about finances early. You want to get a good jump start on it, give compounding, compounding returns an opportunity to work for you instead of against you.
Mm-hmm.
So
what do you think is going to be left for the next generation after the sandwich generation?
Well, actually, I think just a couple of years ago, within the last 5 years, we've hit the negative inheritance situation, where instead of inheriting money from our parents, it's actually costing us money for our parents. So we've got a negative inheritance going on.
Mm.
I'm hoping that doesn't continue, but it probably is going to, because mom and dad have, you know, pretty much run out of money.
Mm-hmm.
For a lot of people.
Yeah,
and so they're turning to their children for help.
Yeah, that is crazy. Do you think tuition prices will ever go down, or will they continue to escalate?
I think eventually they're going to go down.
I think
the technology and the advances today are going to drive college costs down. Now, I have said this for a long time, and it hasn't happened yet.
Mm-hmm.
And I suspect at some point it's going to have to happen, because college costs can't just continue to escalate because people just can't pay it.
No. Oh, yeah.
And when you start crunching the numbers and looking at it, if people start making smart decisions as it relates to sending their children to college, they're going to start making different decisions.
Mm-hmm.
And colleges are going to start taking it on the chin. At some point in time, I don't know when that we're going to turn that corner, but we can't be that far from it.
Mm.
But again, I said the same thing 5-10 years ago. I thought it was coming, and it hasn't. So but at some point it has to.
As they say, nothing happens overnight. And I agree. I know that a lot of trades are suffering because a lot of people are just going straight for the higher education. But I think that trades are going to be suffering so bad that it's going to kind of turn around, where people are going to start getting back into the trades because they're going to realize college is way too much money. They've seen what it's done to their family, put them in debt. And if people are going to realize if they get into a trade and they master the trade, they can end up running their own company and they could end up doing very well for themselves.
I should have you on the show. We talk about that quite a bit. That's exactly what we talk to people about on the show. That's critical. I mean, we have a lot of contractors as clients, and all the contractors are all singing the same sad tune. They don't have enough qualified workers. And so what's going on now is the price for contractors, whether they be plumbers, electrician, I don't care which one it is, the prices are going up and wages are going higher and higher and higher. So that means if you get into the trades, you're going to be making more and more and more money over time. And you can't outsource the trades. You can't ship the trades over to China. Not going to happen.
No.
You've got a leaky toilet. You got to have a plumber come to your house. Somebody isn't going to be able to fix it remotely from India. It's not going to happen. So the trades could be a very good place for people to be going forward. Now, the trades aren't for everybody, but they're certainly for a lot more people than there are going into them today, for sure.
Exactly. And if I could count on my hands how many people, you know, good people, but they go to school. But they get out of school, they realize maybe school wasn't for them, and they're still stuck.
And now they're in debt.
At the same job that they had, you know, in high school or college, and they're in debt. So that's like maybe a trade would have been a better route. But could you tell us about how you got involved with hosting your own radio show on WCRN? You mentioned a couple of seconds ago on how you have a lot of clients that are within the trade business.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, interesting. Years ago, I forget exactly how it happened, but I think it was Chris invited me to be a guest in the morning with Hank Stoltz and Peter Blute back in the day. So I used to come on back then, and I would comment on the financially related things going on that day for a few minutes and hang out, you know, during their show. And I enjoyed doing it. I had a lot of fun doing it. And then Chris asked me to consider doing my own show, which was, you know, scared the daylights out of me at first, but I enjoy doing it, you know, so it's a fun thing to do. And that's why I do it. If it wasn't fun, I wouldn't do it. So I enjoy coming in here once a week and doing a show, and I have a lot of fun doing it.
And that's what counts, you know, doing it for fun and doing it for the love. And, you know, you're very knowledgeable and passionate about the type of work that you do. And I can only imagine that CRN has helped spread the message about your business out to the general public.
Sure. CRN, it's been so much fun, you know, working with all the people. I've met so many good people along the way here. And not only do I enjoy doing the show, I enjoy all the people that I've met here and continue to work with. What? Except for Ted.
I just hope he doesn't hear that. Don't worry, I'll hear him yelling in the next studio over. So, what does the future hold for investment planning? Will there be easier or more advanced tools to help people save?
There's always, in the technology age, is always going to be more and more tools for people to use. The problem becomes is in knowing how and having the education enough to be able to utilize those tools for yourself. So theoretically the tools are out there to be able to do things, but there's a couple things that are going on. One, some people just aren't financially sophisticated and they really don't want to be. We all have different things in life that we're passionate about, and some people really just don't want to deal with finances, and that's fine. That's what people like me are for.
Yeah.
But for people who want to do all these things on their own, then you got to spend a significant amount of time, you know, learning this stuff, because it's not that easy. It really isn't. There's a lot that goes into it. But there are tools. There's a lot of tools available out there that can help you do it. But you just have to be able to understand how to use them and that sort of thing.
What is the future of Triton Financial, and how can people get in contact with you and your services?
Well, we are a growing firm. I'm adding new advisors to come into the fold and learn the trade of comprehensive planning, done the right way, our way. And if you like the idea of comprehensive financial planning, and you like the idea of having somebody who works for you instead of for a large institution, we're a good alternative in that space. And if you'd like to have a conversation, we always do it at free of cost or obligation. And you can just call us 508-480-8383 or visit the website at tritonfinancial.com.
Terrific. Hey, thank you, Bob. I'd like to thank you for coming on to my show today.
My pleasure.
To discuss about
Triton
Financial and the world of finances and how people can learn how to save and the tools and necessities that they need and about your services.
Absolutely. Pat, thanks for having me.
Hey, you're very
welcome.
Enjoy
the weekend.
Hey, you as well. That was Bob G. of Triton Financial, who also is a WCRN host for the show Financial Focus, which you can hear every Wednesday at 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. on AM 830 WCRN. Until next weekend, folks, you can always listen to our latest episodes of WCRN Weekends with Pat Rice on YouTube.com. Just look up WCRN Weekends with Pat Rice.
This has been WCRN Weekend and your host, Pat Rice.